which was first initiated by the WHO in 1988 and is held every year on the 1st of December. So this year marks its 30th anniversary under the theme of Know Your Status. As we would all agree, achieving the 90-90-90 UNAIDS targets by 2020 are critical to meet the Sustainable Development Goal of ending AIDS by 2030. However, latest data shows that 25% of the people living with HIV are still not aware of their status, and less than 60% of those in need of antiretroviral therapy, or ART as it is more commonly known as, are actually able to access it. Also, more than half of the people living with HIV have unsuppressed viral loads, increasing the danger of HIV drug resistance and threatening efforts to end AIDS. The 1.8 million new HIV infections in 2017, out of which 180,000 were children, show that we are failing somewhere down the line. Today's interactive session with key experts will help us find answers to resolve the barriers at ground level that are impeding progress towards ending this disease. A few housekeeping announcements. I request the participants to keep sending their questions and comments even as panelists present, and not wait till the end. You can click on the question and answer box, which you must be seeing on your screen, and then type in your question. If you wish to speak, please click on the virtual hand you see on your screen once the open session begins. In the event of some questions not getting answered due to shortage of time, be welcome to send your queries directly to the panelists later on, whose email IDs we will be sharing with you. I now welcome our guest moderator for today, Ashok Ramsarup, who is a widely acclaimed award-winning journalist based in Durban, South Africa. He was a senior producer at South African Broadcasting Corporation. Over to you, Ashok.
Warm greetings from the port city of Durban in South Africa. Well, I come from a country that has the dubious distinction of having the maximum number of people living with HIV in the world. According to the latest UNAIDS data, South Africa is home to 7.2 million people living with HIV, but of which 4.2 million are women and 280,000 are children, while 90% of these 7.2 million know their status, but only 61% of them are receiving antiretroviral treatment, or ART. Even though the country has the large ART program in the world, also 47% of all PLHIV are virally suppressed, which means that the HIV viral load is undetectable and hence untransmissible. While there has been tremendous progress in the past decade in the efforts to control HIV/AIDS globally, South Africa still have a long way to go to have an AIDS-free society. The HIV epidemic continues to impact key positions as substantially increased risk for HIV infection. HIV-related stigma and discrimination as well has legal barriers disempower people living with HIV and people at risk of HIV infection from accessing available services. While UNAIDS targets of achieving 90-90-90 are not only critical but central to ending AIDS by 2030, we also need to work harder to ensure optimal utilization of every scientific evidence-based prevention option so that new HIV infection rates decline steeply to hit zero as soon as possible. Well, let us hear more from the experts who are here with us today. We are indeed fortunate to have with us Dr. Mitchell Warren, Executive Director, AVAC, and a noted HIV prevention research advocate. Our second panelist is Dr. Ishwar Gilada, President, AIDS Society of India, who is also on the Governing Council of International AIDS Society, IAS. Dr. Gilada is among the first doctors who began HIV care when the first case was diagnosed in India, and is an ardent AIDS campaigner. We have two panelists representing the voices of the community, Soumya Gupta and Amruta Soni. Soumya is a trans activist from India's economic capital, Mumbai. She is president of Transgender Welfare Equity and Empowerment Trust, TWEET Foundation, and is associate program manager for the Hum Safar Trust, an LGBT organization in India. Amruta Soni is a transgender person living with HIV and is working as program manager with the India HIV AIDS Alliance Initiative in the state of Bihar. I now hand over to Shobha Shukla, our managing editor of Citizen News Service and HIV Research for Prevention Sciences Journalism Fellow 2018.
Hello, everybody. I think Dr. Gilada is being a bit delayed. We are so keen to know the ground realities and challenges faced by key populations in realizing the dream of an AIDS-free world. Available data suggests that 47% of the new HIV infections globally in 2017 were among key populations and their sexual partners. I now invite our first speaker, Soumya Gupta, to share with us some of the barriers faced in bringing down HIV transmissions in key affected populations. Yes, Soumya.
Yes. First of all, I would like to thank entire panel for providing me this opportunity to talk about the issues trans community is facing in India. In India, we are remarkably working on HIV prevention with the support of UNAIDS under the 90-90-90 project. To reach out, we are working tremendously to reach out the goals. Also, government and other systems of the country is also providing support as much as possible. Like recently, we have the HIV Act in place, and also so many government policies are working to provide services to the key population. I would like to talk about trans issues here to reach out 90-90-90 goals. I think we need to work on few issues here. More rigorously, we need to work. I think need to provide livelihoods for transgender women in India by providing employment. Till date, approximately 70% of transgender women in India are engaged in the sex work. We all know the risk factors in sex work, and by providing employment services to the trans women community, we can prevent HIV. Also, we need to design programs with the requirement of transgender community. By eliminating stigma and discrimination, to access the services for HIV prevention and ART to improve adherence. I would like to put one more point here. The feminization, the majority of transgender community are in the feminization process, and we all know feminization process is very long going process. By using hormones by using hormones, we need to work on combination of using hormone and ERT treatment, how it impacts, how, we need to sensitize trans community. Also, we need to design programs on AIDS. I think these are the three key points. We need to work closely on employment, trans employment issues, and we need to work on design programs. We need to design more programs like keeping in mind of requirements of the key population. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much for bringing these very important points to light. I would now request Amrita to share her experience and knowledge of what it is to be a positive trans person living in India and why are we failing to stop new HIV infections.
Hi, my name is Amrita Kani. I'm from India and I'm working within a care and support program in India where, and about myself, I'm living with an HIV from 2012. Being as a trans and from a long time, like when I go to the field and usually we see that in many of the ART centers, timing and everything are the timing issues, because the community has the problem for their daily wages. They have to go for an outside for the entire day, and when they come back, till that time the ART centers are closed, so they are not able to access the treatment. There should be a single window access where a community can access the treatment, which is more important, where now the government needs to start thinking on this. At the one shelter, you can say at the one roof, every treatment access can be easily accessed by the trans community. The counseling sessions, which has to be given for the trans community, need to be updated, where the most of the part, if you look, still the counselors are not aware about the gender, what to speak and how to come with an issue to take out the why the trans is facing an issue to access the treatment. There are so many things which we still the community is facing at the ground level. So I want to put up this issue when we say about the 90-90 goal, when the 90-90 has to be reached. So for 90-90 accessing that goal, first we need to understand the needs of the community. Community understanding should be there, which can support to move forward and put the decisions. Thank you, Shobha.
Okay. Anything more about stigma? Do you think there is still a lot of stigma?
Still, we are facing a stigma and discrimination at the ART centers, because when we go walk down to the ART centers, they are still not that easy accessible for us to reach them. And there is again the gender binary, where we always have to, usually most of the transgenders are carrying their real name, the Aadhaar card, but now they are a cross-dress and they have been a trans and the name has been not changed on the Aadhaar card. So they request to ART center that we need to be identified as a he or a she, but still that has been not been identified. Doctors are not so very much, you can say, about physics, about requirement, about HRT, because most trans communities are taking the HRTs as well as ART together, which is facing a side effect where they're going into a second line also.
Yes, please continue.
The stigma, the thing is like, they're not ready to talk to us. This is the big stigma which we are facing, because the community needs to speak now. And the people need to, ART centers need to speak with the community. We need this and what are the issues? Because until the trans person is not going to speak, the community will not have that space to speak. So there should be a community person sitting at the ART centers where they can access easily, or any community-based organizations where the community can access towards the improvement of the treatment.
Any improvements you have seen over the last few years?
There are the improvements in the few states where the Vihan Care and Support is running, and now that we have 10 PGCSEs in India, and we are trying like our best, and it is getting improved. But still, there is a stigma which because PGCSEs are also facing the same problem. When they go to the community and ask to come back to the treatment, who has left from the medicine, the same issues are coming up that when we go to the ART center, we have been asked this question, we have been asked that question. So that's the fear which has been still there. It's slowly reducing, but we are trying our best. And this is not only the one-way process, it should be from the both the side process, where ART centers also need to change the counseling questionnaires which need to be asked to the community while counseling sessions.
All right. Thank you very much. Soumya, would you like to add something to what Amrita has said? Is Soumya there?
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, Soumya.
Yeah.
Yes.
As my sister Amrita from India told that there are so many improvements. As earlier I told, we have so many improvements at policy level in India. Recently, Government of India started implementing HIV Act, which is pending for a long time. After that, there are so many judgments in the perspective of MSMTG population. There are so many judgments. If you see 2014 Supreme Court judgment, NALSA judgment, if you see current September 6th, Section 377, read on, is a booster for the for these projects to work on transgender and MSM issues rigorously to prevent HIV in India by 2030, 2020, whatever.
Okay. Thank you very much. Amrita, there is already a question for you that what has been your experience when you did your MBA as an MBA student?
I am an MBA student, and coming from a marketing and HR background, it was very difficult to get into a corporate the jobs in India. So yes. The sector which was only the HIV/AIDS sector where we get a job. Mm-hmm. And I started working as a peer educator at the ground level, where I was going to the key population and giving them the condoms. I worked with the female sex workers, IUD users, injectable drug users, with different key populations. Mm-hmm. Where one of the project which was a major on a transgender was a Pehchan, where we were into the community testing, where we would do the counseling for the community, taking them to the ICTC, getting that tested, and if they get a positive reactive, then getting them linked to the ART and the follow-up for the ART medicine, proper time to time, their partner testings, and everything was going on very smoothly till the pattern was then run by most of the community-based organizations in India. But currently, like, we need that type of a programs in India for a transgender community, where like along with that, some skill building training part for a community where they can get skilled up and trained up and move into the more development sectors towards the community benefit. Because always still having MBA post-graduation, I am still fighting with my double status. Like, I am being discriminated as a transgender. Second discrimination was that I'm living with an HIV. Because I'm open out with my status in media and everywhere on each platform, I say that I'm an HIV positive. So always I also have to face a double stigma while going out and coming out and speaking also. But then also I decided that I should not hide it. I should open out and speak. Until I speak, looking at me, many people can come out and speak. So I started open out and speaking out and moving out towards the development sector.
Yeah, you have been doing great service, great work, Soumya and you. So laws are important, but laws are not enough by themselves. How should the community be responding? Do you think there is something more forthcoming which could come from the community side as well?
As the point of the community, I would like to say that, see, we always welcome each and every judgment. As Soumya said, that there are so many judgments which has come down recently in India. So we welcome each and every judgment, but that all are on a black and white paper for me. Because until the human being decides from their heart and the mentally both comes together and they start thinking one decision, then we will not able to face any of these things. And most of my sisters are only looking towards the support and also only looking towards the one step forward from the society. We are ready to take 10 steps forward towards the society.
Okay. Soumya, would you like to share something of your experience as a student? You have been studying science, and is there, can we get some overview also of the epidemic in the key populations?
Yeah. If you see in the scenario where I completed my study in 1998, right now we are in 2018, there are so many changes in the society, in the community, in the so many things. So as Amrita said, community is also working on inclusiveness. Like if you see Feet Foundation, if you see Hum Safar Trust are working rigorously on employment issues very focusively. And there are so many corporates also ready to work with transgender community. But one thing here missing is that providing an opportunity. So many corporates are ready to work with transgender community, but somewhere we need to streamline all the things providing a friendly atmosphere in workplaces and provide support to trans population by skill building opportunities and all. As you said, as Amrita said, all the laws are in papers. Somewhere need to work on implementation also. For example, if you see NALSA judgment, 2014 NALSA judgment, after the NALSA judgment, till the time there is no specific implementation of NALSA, which is more important. In 2016, transgender persons bill also tabled in the parliament. Still it was not yet passed. And as a community members, we also don't know much about the current status of the bill, whether parliamentary standing committee recommendations are incorporated or not. We need to work on that. We are eagerly waiting for government stand on transgender persons bill 2016.
Thank you very much, Soumya. And I'm really grateful for Dr. Michelle Warren to have joined us. Sorry, Michelle, to wake you up at this unearthly hour from New York. And over to you now.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, Shobha. I was just on mute and I was just unmuting myself. Thanks so much. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very clearly. And thank you very much.
My great pleasure. Thank you so much for having me. Sorry to be joining you a little bit late. And maybe I'll just say a couple of words very quickly, really on this important topic. And,
yes.
And I think as we think about this whole idea of 90-90-90 and ending AIDS, people often set up these timeframes, 2020 or 2030. And I think it's important to recognize that no matter what the target date might be, the work that needs to be done right now is so important. And I think one of the big challenges we've had is that the idea of 90-90-90 has often been reduced to this idea of the treatment side of the HIV response. And that is obviously an essential component. But the whole concept of epidemic control relies not only on reaching the treatment targets of diagnosis, of treatment, and of viral suppression, but of the additional essential needs for primary prevention, for stigma reduction, and ideally elimination, and for human rights approaches, which you heard about just throughout this call. And I think it's that idea of a comprehensive, integrated, and sustained response. And from my perspective, and I run an organization called AVAC that looks at these issues from an advocacy and policy and implementation perspective, it's really coming down to the need to deliver what we have today in 2018 and soon 2019, which means comprehensive prevention, including condoms and oral pre-exposure prophylaxis or PrEP. It's about doing this in a rights-based approach, and obviously it's about treatment. So delivering all that we have today. But at the same time, if we really are going to end this epidemic, we have to think about two additional components. So beyond delivering what we have today, we have to demonstrate the added value of newer interventions. So oral PrEP has now been with us for some number of years, but it's not really available in most countries. Of the 350,000 or so people in the world who are on oral PrEP, 2/3 of those are in the United States. Another large proportion are coming in Europe, Kenya, and South Africa. But that means whole parts of the world aren't yet getting access to PrEP. So it's not just delivering, but we have to demonstrate the added value, particularly in countries where we haven't even begun the process of understanding where PrEP fits. But even beyond delivering and demonstrating, perhaps for me, the long-term need for a durable end, a long-term end of the epidemic, is that we have to maintain a development perspective. And that means developing the next generation of products, particularly in the long term, a vaccine and even potentially a cure if that's possible. So it's really that comprehensive, integrated, and sustained response, delivering what we have at scale, treatment and prevention, demonstrating the added value, oral PrEP right now. Soon, we hope, the dapivirine vaginal ring, looking forward into 2019, the next innovation on the agenda. But then, as I say, developing next generation PrEP, injectables, other modes of delivery, and ultimately a vaccine and a cure. And it's only when we take all of that in combination do I think we can really fundamentally end the epidemic. And we have to be very clear about that, because I think one thing, thinking ahead to 2019 and into 2020, that the risk of declaring success too soon is quite real. Because if we declare success too soon, before we really have this durable end of an epidemic, which I think will require a vaccine, it means that funders, policymakers, and communities may begin to think that, well, we've reached a certain target of treatment numbers or of circumcision numbers, or you pick your target. People run the risk of losing the political commitment and the resources by declaring success too soon. So we have to be sure that we recognize progress, because there has been tremendous progress. And we should all be celebrating that sitting here at the end of 2018. But we shouldn't confuse that progress with ultimate success in our work, because that is going to require many more years, much greater investment, much more intensive engagement with communities and policymakers and the media and funders. And we have to maintain that long-term view. So maybe I'll just stop there. And really just grateful to add into this conversation, and I'm happy to talk about any of those issues further.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Michelle, for being with us today. And now we have finally managed to get Dr. Ishwar Gilada, who has been shuttling between airports. Welcome, Dr. Gilada. Can you tell us where we are in the fight against HIV AIDS in the Southeast Asia region? with special reference to India. You have been doing great work in India. Yes, Dr. Gilada. He is there, I think. We will just give him a minute to get online.
1990. However, when you see this 1990 target, it is a very difficult target to meet, but all the governments, 193 countries have signed, and they are looking at the real meeting of this target. I would like to go through my slides to show you. My first slide shows that we are on a vulnerable point. If you look at the UNAIDS, the Government of India data, they show from 1998 how the HIV numbers, we are not talking about real numbers, but their estimates, they are coming down. And to some extent, they have come down in last 4 or 5 years or maybe 10 years. However, what I predict that the numbers are going to go up again because of the second bout of HIV wave, or the same thing has been seen in some of the European countries. We also see a lot of STIs or STDs, which are now increasing, which were already low. Can I have my next slide, please? Now, if you look at snapshot of Southeast Asia, where they are looking at currently 157,000 newly infected people in 1 year, and that has to be brought down in next 2 years to 89,000. So possibly this may be done, but this may not be done because we also see sometimes numbers are down because of deaths also. So we have to bring down the deaths also. Next. That India has adopted WHO's test and treat strategy on 28th of April 2017. HIV AIDS Prevention Bill, which is now an act, has been passed in Parliament and now it is a law, which is implemented. Introduction of a new integrase inhibitor, dolutegravir, which is called the robust, one of the most robust antiretrovirals, STR, that is a single tablet regimen with lower dose of efavirenz, which was rather than 600, now made 400. So it's more tolerable with less side effects and more people can take it, and cost is also low. Tenofovir alafilamide, which has come, and also in combination with lamivudine, this, the side effects related to tenofovir has come down. Darunavir, ritonavir combination has come, both in 55 years. What we are talking about few years back, only 5 years survival to HIV positive people. Now we can straightway talk about 50 years. So 5 to 50 jump has happened just in 10 to 15 years of time. We have PrEP, beach PrEP, etc. And what's, go ahead, next slide. 92% of the people living with HIV in the world, they are accessing Indian ARVs. And that is one of the biggest plus points for India. Maybe coming next year or so, TLD combination has been made available in India, and we are going to have TED, TAF-ED and TAF-LD in pipeline, and maybe in next 1 to 2 years they will be launched. And we also see vanishing pediatric ARVs. So this is a big problem for children with HIV. Next, please. Now, if you look at goals and targets of NACP, they would like to end epidemic by 2030. That is the SDG goal, and that is all over the world. 2024, they want to achieve 95, 95, 95, upscaling from 1990. And by 2020, which is just hardly 2 years from now, they want to achieve the new infection rate to be down by 75% rather than 90%. Next, please. So if you look at different combinations available, earlier we were saying people that either no sex or sex with condom. There are several prevention combinations available. There's a PEP, there's a PrEP, there are vaginal microbicide, the female condom available, the male condom with different varieties, different sizes, different shapes, different flavors. There are the treatment as prevention. So all these things, combination, we can see that HIV is really coming down and come down further. So it's not only one thing. Next, please. And we have seen treatment as prevention. So in a couple situation, if one partner is treated, we prevent infection in another partner by 96%. And therefore, the target has become prevention and prevention and through prevention, treatment as prevention. Next, please. And so the focus, which was prevention is the only treatment earlier, It has now gone to now treatment as prevention. Next, please. PrEP has come. However, PrEP is not yet licensed in India, but privately we are using it because no one can stop it. But in the program, it is not available. Next, please. So, ending epidemic by 2030, ending means it will not be zero. From 157,000, it has to be brought to 20,000. So it is good, as good as negligible new infections. Next, please. And by 2020, would like to see what these are the ideal targets. When you talk about ideal target of 90-90-90, is not 10% less. It is 90% of 90% of 90%. It is only 73%. So even if you are able to reach this target, your total points at hand will be 73%, not even distinction of 75%. Next, please. However, with its own admission, the government of India says that we have 2.1 million infection, but out of which 1.9 million are diagnosed. And on ART, 1.7 million. And these are the target for India. And 1.5 million should have viral suppression. But what is the reality? You can see. Next slide. The reality is that viral load is not yet in a big way in the program. They have upscaled from almost 10,000 to 100,000 viral load now, but the requirement is another 10 times more than that. And we have 20% people yet to know their status, and 50% people, almost 500,000 people, they are yet to be on ART. So our targets are hardly reaching around 30 or 40% from the targeted of 73% point at the end. Next, please. So basically, components of National AIDS Control Program are prevention, test, and treat. So test and treat has become a big way now. Everywhere, almost all 500 ART centers and 1,000 plus or 1,050 linked centers, they are looking at test and treat strategy. So rather than 250, 350, 500 CD4 count, it has become test and treat everywhere. Next, please. So in first 90, we are lacking somewhere. Next, where we are lacking is basically, if you look at the map of India, there are high positivity and high coverage states, which comprises Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, and Telangana, where the HIV is high, but even prevention campaigns are high. But there are some places where high positivity and low coverage, and that is most dangerous. And that is a Hindi heartland of India, mostly Bihar, UP, etc. Next, please. So we need to increase our testing strategies through voluntary, through based on clinical suspicion, through partner testing, through antenatal clinic, through preoperative in patients, and through blood banks. And all this is happening to some extent. However, next, please. But there is a cohort effect. What kind of awareness we created as a nation, as organizations, as individuals, about 10, 15 years back. At that time, it was everywhere preventive campaigns were there. Those people which were children at that time, they are now adults now. And they have not gone through the campaign in the last 10 years. So this is a cohort effect. And we need to support this kind of campaign in these people. And what has happened with NACO, National AIDS Control Organization, when they have gone ahead to test and treat and care and support, they have forgotten some of the strategies of prevention and intervention. And some interventions are now closed down or they are weak. Next, please. So we need to involve young people. We need to involve social media, social networking forays, and mobile apps. Next, please. You have to catch them young. So steps to achieve first 90 and elimination of all HIV infection as well as the syphilis, they need a lot of strategy, and Government of India is working on that. I don't want to elaborate more than that. Next, please. So this is India Scale-Up Program on Counseling and Testing Services. So Government of India and NACO, they have done really wonderful work to reach almost everywhere. Next, please. In second 90, where we need to put people on treatment, India has done wonderful in a very short span of time. And almost 70 to 80% people with HIV infection who know their status, they are put on treatment. And moreover, India's contribution to the world, a lot of times India has been called a copycat, that we are copying from patent owners' medicine making generics. But something which we invented, that is 3-in-1 combination. And that is, we did not patent, but all over the world, they are copying single tablet regimen. And that has been first done in India. and whole world has copied that. So this is a major gift from India to the rest of the world. Next, please. In third 90, we are lagging far behind. Next, please. And we need to upscale our viral load testing almost all over the country. There is a private-public partnership by which 10,000 viral load in a year has now gone to 100,000, possibly 160,000. But our requirement is 10 times more, as I stated earlier. So ending epidemic or ending AIDS by 2030, that means from 3.3 million new infection, it has to come down to 1.77 million infection. Next, please. So where are we in viral load? As I already said, that we are lagging far behind and we need to do upscale, a lot of upscaling to be done. Next, please. In advocacy role, what ASI is doing is a health insurance. Health insurance should cover HIV, because once when we say that people with HIV are living longer as much as a normal life, why health insurance people are not covering HIV? Death certificate should not mention HIV, because that creates a discrimination even after the person dies and in the family of the person. Non-discriminatory practice in medical practices, they're still labeled as HIV positive or zero positive or some precautions or isolation. That should not be there. There should be HIV friendly referral network. There should be adoption should be made available to HIV positive people if they are not able to have their own child. Prevention of partner cheating, that has to be there, because sometimes people are marrying without disclosing their HIV status. And there are positive marriages happening. There are positive negative alliances also happening. And that is with knowledge. Next, please. So at the end, I would like to tell that there are some game changers. And in the game changers, NACO has played a human role in last 1.5 years. So this year, when we are completing 30 years of the World AIDS Day, there are a lot of positive things to tell to the rest of the world, that India is not only second or third largest in HIV infection, but on the other hand, India has been a savior globally. That 92% of the people living with HIV AIDS, they are taking Indian medicine, which are costing 1% or less than 1% of international cost. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gilada. Having heard medical experts and experts from the community, we now open the question and answer session and invite the participants for their comments as well as questions. You can click on the question and Q&A box, which you must be seeing on your screen, and then type in your question. If you wish to speak, please click on the virtual hand you see on your screen once the open session begins. Michelle, thank you for your remarks. There's a question for you. If it is possible to increase utilization of existing prevention options to cut down transmission of HIV, we are doing bad with what we already have in hand. So how do you say that should be scaled up? Yes, Michelle.
Hey, Shobha, thank you. Just trying to get off mute.
Yes.
It's a great question. And one of the things I'd say is that we very often have seen in the last several years that people get very focused on specific prevention options. So condoms or oral PrEP, or in a number of African countries, voluntary medical male circumcision. And one of the things we are beginning to see in a number of studies are that some of the barriers to using any of those options are not specific to the product. They are about the overarching program. Just earlier this week, we were presenting some findings of a project we're working on in South Africa, focused on young women in South Africa. And in terms of understanding prevention. And one of the things we clearly found is that while there are barriers to condom use, while there are barriers to oral PrEP, that many of the challenges had nothing to do with the products, male condom, female condom, or PrEP. It had to do with young people's perspective and perception of their own risk, of their interaction with the healthcare system, with their interaction with their peers and their sexual partners. And although we've known that for some time, I don't think we've seen programs adequately address it. So rather than just promoting condoms or promoting PrEP, it's about redesigning our programs with the user in mind or the potential user, so that we are delivering a comprehensive program that gives them choices. So I think although we certainly still need additional prevention options, with the ones we have, we could be having greater impact if we realigned our programs to be more responsive to their individual needs. And I think that is the clarion call going into 2019 about a whole new way, not only of designing the products, but more importantly of designing the programs that deliver a range of options to people. And that's the message, I think, for 2018 and going forward.
Thank you, Michelle. We have a few questions, rather doubts, which Manoj Kumar Chaurasia wants to get clarified. Manoj is vice president of an organization called Yuvaon Ki Duniya, which loosely translates into the world of the youth. He has these few questions, and I'm sure Dr. Gilada would answer them. Manoj's first question is, what to do if someone has AIDS? Can one get infected by sharing the same food with a person living with HIV or by kissing a person living with HIV?
You see, HIV is not transmitted by day-to-day activities. Sharing the same food, sharing the same kitchen, sharing the same bathroom, sharing the same swimming pool. And if the HIV has to be caused by that way, I think I should have been the first person to get HIV. I've been working with HIV for the last 33 years now. So HIV, actually the first thing, fear has to go away from your mind, that HIV can be that easily transmitted. To give you another example, if mother is having HIV and she is pregnant, even without treatment, without any ART, the child's chance to get HIV is only 20 to 30%. It is not 100%. So when the child is in the home of a mother who is HIV positive, taking, getting blood supply, nutrition supply, taking breastfeeding, everything, despite that, every child doesn't get. Your husband and wife setting, if husband is positive, wife staying together for 10 years, the wife's chance to get HIV, even unprotected sex, without ART, is hardly 50%. So HIV is not that easily transmitted. Moreover, HIV, hepatitis C and hepatitis B, if you compare, if person has all the three infection, hepatitis B is 100 times more transmissible than HIV. Hepatitis C is 10 times more transmissible than HIV. People are not scared about those infections. People are not taking even hepatitis B vaccine, which is costing pittance. I don't know why people are so much scared of HIV.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Gilada. Maybe there is still a lot of lack of awareness. And our next question is from J.V. Sriram, who's a team leader at Swayam Prabha, which is a TV channel for education. And Sriram wants to know what steps should be taken to create awareness amongst the Indian youth.
I think when you talk young child to keep their nose clean, to keep their hands clean, keep their mouth clean, don't use abusive words. At the same time, when the child is growing further and further, you should keep on adding the components of sexuality, child sexual abuse, prevention of child sexual abuse, HIV and STDs. In Indian society, having pregnancy is considered good news that somebody is pregnant. But the same sexual activity can give you pregnancy and that can give you HIV. And that is considered bad news or sad news. And nobody wants to discuss. So I think we should talk this as a part of a regular health curriculum, not as only HIV or say sex education. Sex education is a taboo word in a lot of society people, in schools and in a lot of colleges also, or in families. So the moment I say, I'm going to give sex education, parents will say, no, I don't want to send my children to Dr. Gilada's lecture because he will make them sexy. By giving my lecture, they don't become sexy. But at the same time, if I say, we're going to have a health education. In health education, there are different components, including living together, or marriage, or married life, or sexual life. And then nobody will oppose.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from District Program Manager with Maharashtra State AIDS Control Society. So Dr. Gilada, I think the question is directed to you. And he wants full and complete details about 90-90-90 to end AIDS. You have dwelt upon it, but since this was a specific question, I think, and he's from the State AIDS Control Society. So please, can you explain?
The importance of 90-90-90 is that a lot of people who are infected, they do not know their status. probably they have not been tested. Why they are not been tested? Because they do not consider themselves in any risk category. They always look at somebody else, that somebody else had gone to sex worker for 100 times. He did not get. Why do I get? They always think that he is a great person. He has a great immunity. He doesn't get any disease. Or she doesn't. I'm talking he because a lot of times male are infected first from other sexual activity. Women are as a kind of a passerby from men to women transmission, particularly in family setting. So they do not consider themselves at risk. And therefore, we need to find out those who are infected, but they do not know their status. And whatever strategies are to be devised, they should be done so that those 20-30% people or 40% people who do not know their status, they come to know. Out of those people who know their status, 90% should be on ART. So basically, there are still people, they think that ART are harmful, ART will give rise some of the side effects, and by taking ART, their life will be reduced because ART may work for 5-10 years, thereafter it may not work. So we have to tell them that there are newer ARTs have come, they are robust ARVs. It's not only beneficial to them that by taking ART, they will be preventing their morbidity and mortality and death, but they will be also preventing their spouse. If spouse is pregnant, their offspring. So it is undetectable, becomes untransmittable. And then those which are on treatment, they should be regularly on treatment, they should be adherent, they should be virally suppressed. Virally suppressed means if viral load is done, viral load should come undetectable. And nowadays with a robust treatment like with the dolutegravir, it is coming TND, that is target not detected. So by doing that, we are able to achieve one of the best results in HIV positive people. And those which are HIV negative, they should continue to remain negative. So basically this year theme is know your status. Not only your personal status, not your family status, social status, financial status, but know your status for HIV also.
Thank you. We have a question from Catherine Mwakufa, who is a print media columnist from Zimbabwe, and she's a past CNS fellow. Is the growing threat of antimicrobial resistance hampering the progress to end HIV/AIDS? I'm sure Michelle and Dr. Gilada both would like to answer this. Yes, Dr. Gilada.
If you look at the program, entire HIV program, there are two weakest programs in HIV field. One is the vaccine and second is the antimicrobial side. So we do not see much of a headway in both the fields. In microbicide, there is something which is actually tenofovir only, nothing else beyond that. And in vaccine, nothing is successful till today. They have done 31 kind of vaccine trial, none of them is successful. There are 87 or 88 candidate vaccine, nothing is successful. So we need to do more on these fronts. I'm not a virologist or a microbiologist, so I cannot comment more on that. But these are the two of the weakest links or weakest program in HIV.
Michelle, would you like to say something?
Sure. So I think there are actually a couple of things I'd add. One, I think that part of the question was about, in addition to thinking about microbicides and vaccines, the whole idea of antimicrobial resistance, which is a very large issue. And I don't think it's necessarily changing the AIDS response, but surely, and I think very clearly, the World Health Organization has identified antimicrobial resistance as a priority, as is HIV. So I think they can be moving forward together, and both do require a great deal more research. And just to add to Dr. Gilada's response, I think for people to be aware of and just looking into the new year, there'll a number of things on both microbicides and vaccines that I would want people to be aware of. One is there also is a vaginal ring with an antiretroviral called dapivirine. It has been shown in two trials to be safe and effective, only partially effective, and very much like oral PrEP, it relies on adherence, that people, that women keep the ring in for the whole month. But when they do get protection from HIV. That's what's been seen in clinical trials, and regulatory agencies are now reviewing that data, and that may become an additional prevention option in the next year. So that is a very exciting advance, this idea that a woman could control her risk and use the vaginal ring, much like the female condom. So we could have a new prevention option in 2019. And then just to add also about vaccines, there are now two large trials of two different vaccine candidates that are in these late stage trials to see if they actually are safe and effective. One of them is a modification of the vaccine that was studied in Thailand a decade ago that was shown to be very partially protected, but very importantly, this trial in South Africa is trying to build on that result. And we may see the results by 2020 or 2021. And at the same time, there's a different vaccine that has been developed by Johnson & Johnson, a large company, that has been shown in early animal studies to be very, very effective. But those are studies in monkeys. And obviously, we're not interested in preventing infections in monkeys. We're trying to prevent them in human beings. So this large trial in 5 Southern African countries will help us understand if that vaccine might work. So we have more vaccine candidates and trials than ever before, and a lot of excitement looking ahead to 2020, 2021. And then finally, there's a whole new body of research around what are called neutralizing antibodies. This is one of the newest areas of research that has grown in the last decade, and there are 2 large trials and several more on the horizon looking at how to deliver these antibodies. So rather than a vaccine that would work with your body's immune system to protect you, the antibody itself, scientists think, might protect all by itself. But that's, again, a concept that's being studied right now, and there are going to be some results in 2020 around those antibodies that will also tell us a great deal. So I think, again, while the focus is rightly on delivering what we have to get us to 90-90-90, which is essential, it's also essential that we look forward to these new innovations to be added to the mix, not instead of anything we have today, but in addition to those. So we really, again, and I think you've heard this from all the speakers, have this comprehensive, integrated, and sustained response.
Thanks for that very important updates, not one, but many updates. We have a question from Ruth Oni. Ruth is online. Ruth, would you like to ask the question yourself? If you want to ask yourself, you may do so. Okay, she has sent the question also, so I'm asking on her behalf. She has a question about the injectable ARVs that are planning to be implemented. She wants to know if there are studies being done to show any potential side effects when taken with HRT, and what is being done to assist the trans community in managing their health. So we have 2 people.
I think injectable ARVs will come in next year or so. They are cabotegravir and rilpivirin injections. The trials are quite successful, and there have been 2 different trials where either they are given once a month or once in 2 months, and both are successful. So if and when it comes, it can be given to only those people which are virally suppressed for more than 2 years. So to be able to take that injection, it's not a vaccine, basically. You have to stop all the ARVs after 2 years of your viral suppression. So we have actually, that has been a kind of great impetus for us to counsel people that if you are regularly doing viral load and if you are virally suppressed, then injection will help you. And a lot of people are getting interested. I don't know whether the injection will come at affordable cost in India or not, but possibly it may come also because looking at the track record.
And I think one thing to add, Dr. Gilad is absolutely right. In addition, what I think is also exciting to note is that one of those 2 injectables, cabotegravir, in addition to being part of a potential treatment with an injection, cabotegravir is being studied in 2 large trials as a preventive PrEP agent as well, and it's being studied to get it every 2 months. So many people have said oral PrEP is hard because you have to take a pill every day. For some people, getting an injection every 2 months might be beneficial. So we'll have results of that in the next couple of years as well. It's important to note that, as Dr. Gilad said, we don't know what the cost will be. We also don't know what the system challenges might be. So while it might be easier for an individual to go to a clinic every 2 months and not take a pill every day, our health systems to deal with massive numbers of people needing an injection every 2 months, that presents a different challenge. So there's a lot to be looking for, both positively, but also some potential challenges. And just on the last part, the issue of the trans community and the side effects, one of the two trials for prevention with cabotegravir. It's being studied specifically in gay men and other men who have sex with men, as well as in transgender women having sex with men. The trial is actually enrolling larger numbers of transgender individuals than any other prevention trial has ever done. So we will have much better information about the interaction of that injectable with other hormones and in a number of different populations. So that's another one to definitely be looking forward to.
We have a question from a journalist from Bangladesh. He wants to know, Dr. Gilada, is there an AIDS Medical Experts National Network in Bangladesh too? And is the AIDS Society of India training and sensitizing doctors outside of India?
Thank you very much for this question. In fact, at this recently held National Conference of AIDS Society of India, ASICON 2018, we decided that we should increase our mandate to include Southeast Asia, including Bangladesh. So possibly we can do some programs in Bangladesh. If there are some takers, so we don't mind spending from our side a little bit and reaching Bangladesh also, as they're our neighbors.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, I have a question for you. A week ago, I read some data in Hindustan Times, a newspaper of India, that in 2017, over 92% of the new HIV infections were because of unsafe sex in Mumbai, India, in the city of Mumbai. What's your message to make safe sex campaigns work better?
Well, another great question. And I think one of the things that's very important is understanding where those infections are. So, and this is true in many countries, that we tend to think about a national program or campaign. And clearly, if that day, I don't know that data directly, but not all communities and not all states or cities have the same levels of infection. So first of all, understanding the data is very important to know where those new infections are coming from. And I think at the end of the day, a lot of this comes down to something that UNAIDS had said in one of the World AIDS Day programs over a decade ago, and that is know your epidemic, know your response. It's not just knowing that it's in Mumbai, it's knowing which communities in Mumbai. Is it in the transgender community? Is it in people who inject drugs? And really tailoring our strategies to meet the needs of people. You know, very often our prevention programs are based on good ideas, good science, but without fully understanding the individual. And the analogy I would make is if I'm marketing a new cell phone in India, or if I'm marketing a new brand of beer, I really spend time understanding my potential user and then trying to develop my campaigns and my delivery to meet them where they are, as opposed to where I am. And I think we've not done as good a job as we need to for decades with our prevention programs in doing exactly that, of listening to what people want, where they want it, when they want it, and how they want it, and then designing our programs with them in mind, instead of with our big scientific ideas driving everything. So we have to be really much more attentive to the communities, listen to them, and let them be our guides in what is going to work for them.
Thank you. We have a comment from Dr. Maka Mablava, who is managing director of GIEDO, Grassroots Initiative for Youth and Elderly Development Organization in Tanzania. Dr. Maka says, government should put more efforts for combination preventions in collaboration with faith-based organizations, CSOs, CBOs, private sector, formal and informal sectors, and communities, including key vulnerable populations. This would lead to a more impact on HIV control. Before we end today's session, I would like all our four panelists to give their message or some insight for World AIDS Day, which happens to be tomorrow. So can we have from Soumya? Soumya, can you give your message, please?
Yeah. Namaste from India. I would like to give my statement. Have safe sex. Save the lives, stop AIDS, HIV prevention need to be work properly with the communities more effectively.
Thank you. Dr. Gilada?
My advice is be good. If you can't be good, be careful. In any case, be informed. And know your status. Apart from any other status, you should know your HIV status. And even if HIV status is positive, don't feel ashamed.
Amrita?
From my side, the message is we are looking forward for the love, and always my sisters are thirsty of a love, and if we start getting that love, and I hope if we get this all, soon we'll be able to reduce, as sir has said, in India we are able to reach more and more transgender populations also through TGCSEs, and that is giving a change which always has guidance and support are there. So my message is to all, join our hands to take my sisters to the treatment and save their lives.
Thank you. Michelle?
I would say this is a moment to really reflect and realize much accomplished, much to do. There's much to celebrate in our progress as a global community in a rights-based approach, but there is so much more to do. We must not be happy with where we are. We need to be proud of some of the accomplishments, concerned about what hasn't been achieved, and recommit ourselves to truly ending the epidemic and understanding what that means. So I would say celebrate that there has been much accomplished, but recommit that we have much, much, much more work to do.
Yes, and the last few miles are the most difficult ones also.
Always.
And also, while knowing our HIV status is important, I think it is equally important to be aware of the status of our overall health, including the status of sexually transmitted infections, communicable diseases like tuberculosis, non-communicable illnesses like diabetes, hypertension, cancers. To quote the UNAIDS Executive Director, Michelle Sidbe, knowledge is power, the power of people to determine the right options to keep healthy, and the power to stay well and live long and productive lives. Let's ensure that everyone has that power. With that, we come to the close of our webinar today. My sincere thanks to all our panelists for a very enriching discussion. We are grateful to the participants for their engagement with the webinar. And last but not the least, special thanks to our guest moderator, Ashok Ramsarup. As always, the link to the webinar recording and podcast will be shared with all the participants and will soon be available in public domain. Thank you and have a good day.